May 1919, World War I had just ended and Europe was seeing a major political revolution. And at the same time, the world of science was about to undergo a major revolution as well. Two teams of astronomers set out from England through the Atlantic Ocean. One team went to the island of Principe in West Africa and the other went to Sobral in Brazil. They were there to observe the solar eclipse, but the sun is not what interested them. Instead, they'd come to observe a cluster of stars that appear close to the sun when seen from Earth. Normally, they would be blocked by the sun's light, but the eclipse gave them an opportunity. They took out their telescopes and measured the positions of these stars. What they saw shocked them. The observations they made were inconsistent with the predictions from Newton's law of gravity. Newton was wrong. Hi, my name is Pranav and you're watching scienceisdope. In this video, we're going to look at how Newton's model of gravity was dethroned to make way for probably the most revolutionary theory in modern science. Now, this wasn't the first time that Newton's theory was not able to explain something. One such example was the discrepancy in the planet Mercury's orbit. According to Newton, every object in the universe attracts every other object. This force, called the gravitational force, increases the heavier the objects are and decreases the further away they are from each other. This is the reason behind apples falling from trees and planets revolving around the sun. In fact, one of the consequences of Newton's theory was that planets revolve in elliptical orbits around the sun, and that is what we observe. However, scientists at the time had carefully observed the trajectory of Mercury. And even though Newton's theory predicted the rough outline of its orbit, there were some major deviations that could not be ignored. So we knew that there were problems with Newton's model of gravity and we needed a better model. But there wasn't a better theory yet with sufficient evidence in favor of it. And this is where the astronomers came in. These astronomers were led by Arthur Eddington, the then secretary of the Royal Astronomical Society of Britain. And when they made their voyage to observe the eclipse, they had not come unprepared. They had another theory in their arsenal and they wanted to see if the calculations from this theory would match with what they observed. You might have heard of this theory. It's called the theory of general relativity by Albert Einstein. Einstein in 1915 had published his general theory of relativity. According to him, gravity was not a force between two objects. Rather, it was the effect of an object's mass causing the space around it to curve. The curve was more near heavier objects when compared to lighter objects. One such heavy object was the sun, and this curvature would make the planets move as if they are attracted by the sun. And if they had a sideways velocity, they would fly off in a straight line. And if they had some velocity but not enough, they would fall into orbit around the sun. And these orbits would appear elliptical around the sun. In addition to this, Einstein's theory made yet another bizarre prediction. He claimed that even light would bend in the vicinity of such objects. Light would follow this curve near the object. In fairness, Newton's theory predicted this as well, but the bend predicted by Einstein was twice that of Newton's gravity model. Now, did the scientific community accept this model in 1915? Of course not. They don't just accept a theory like that, especially one with such bizarre ideas like the curvature of space-time or gravity is not a force. Extraordinary theories require extraordinary evidence, which it did not have for 4 years. The 1919 eclipse, however, was going to change all that. In the night sky, we can see a lot of stars because light from them reaches the Earth. When this light falls on our eyes, we can tell where the star is. Normally, this light would travel in a straight line towards our eyes, and so we just extrapolate that straight line to find the position of the star. However, according to Einstein's theory, if the sun were to come between the star and the Earth, its light would be bent by the curved space-time around the sun. The star would then appear at a different position than what's normally expected. Einstein's theory predicted value for this deviation that's almost twice what Newton's theory predicted. And this deviation was what Arthur Eddington set out to measure. He would compare the position of the star under two scenarios: when the sun was between the star and the Earth, and when it was not. But there was a catch. When the sun comes between the star and the earth, the dim light from the star will not be visible because of the bright light from the sun. Due to this, we cannot observe the starlight, meaning we cannot make observations at all. This is why we needed an eclipse. During an eclipse, the moon comes between the sun and the earth, blocking the sun's light. And this would make the dim light of the star easier to observe. When Einstein published his theory in 1915, the First World War was in progress, and Britain and Germany were on opposite sides, meaning direct communication was impossible. This did not deter Eddington. He obtained a smuggled copy of Einstein's papers and put them to the test in 1919. The eclipse had a path from Brazil to West Africa, and Eddington had organized two teams, one for Brazil and one for Africa. Viewing an eclipse can often be a challenge. If clouds block your view of the sun, then you're gonna have to wait until another eclipse, and that might not happen in your part of the world for years. In case one team couldn't observe the eclipse, he wanted the other team to do it. And that's why there were two teams. Now, they were going to observe a group of stars called the Hyades cluster in the Taurus constellation, which would be around the outer periphery of the sun. They set up their telescopes and captured the positions of these stars on photographic plates. And then they made the long journey back to England, and in London, the two teams met and they measured and compared the positions of stars that they had captured on their plates. They compared these positions with the positions of stars under normal circumstances when the sun is not there. And in fact, they did see a deflection, and these deflections matched perfectly with Einstein's theory, the error being within the limits of observational precision. This was the first time there was conclusive evidence in favor of general relativity. As expected, this created a storm in the scientific community. Newton's theory, which had stood for 200 years, was being challenged by another model. And this model had sufficient evidence to back it up. And if you live in the 21st century, then you know that Einstein's models did replace Newton's models. Einstein became a celebrity overnight and would remain so for the rest of his life and even after his death. Since then, this experiment and many more have been repeated many times, and each solar eclipse would confirm the same thing. Newton's theory was dethroned by Einstein's relativity. There are two reasons why I like the story a lot. It shows that there is no place for authority in science. Just because a model had survived and thrived for 200 years, or that it was made by this well-accomplished person, doesn't mean it'll be accepted forever. By the way, if it is, it's called a dogma. When a new and better model shows up, and if it makes better predictions with evidence, then it's gonna replace the old outdated model. It doesn't matter who said what or how great or famous a scientist is. The only thing that matters is the evidence and how convincing it is. Can the same be said about dogmas or ideas from religion, etc.? I don't think so. For me, this is the beauty and uniqueness of the scientific method. And if you want to learn more about the scientific method, I've got an entire playlist. Another interesting aspect of this was that this whole story took place during World War I, and Britain and Germany were on opposite sides during the war. A British scientist took painstaking efforts to supply evidence for a German scientist's theory. This shows how there are no geographical boundaries in science. There is no British science and German science. There is no Eastern science and Western science. No matter which part of the world a model comes from, if it can make better predictions and if those predictions match what can be observed, then it'll replace existing models. Evidence is all that matters. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, remember, science is dope.